Thermochemistry involves reactions that include solutions. These are different from other reactions because the heat of formation of the solution includes not only the heat of formation of the solute, but also the heat of the solution itself. And this heat of solution is a function of R. R is equal to the moles of solvent, which is usually water, divided by the moles of solute. And so you look it up in an appropriate table to find the heat of solution that corresponds with your particular R. Let's take a look at a typical example. We have sulfuric acid, and it's going to be neutralized by sodium hydroxide, and that's going to leave us with water and a salt, sodium sulfate. One mole of the aqueous H2SO4, and it's going to be 15% bimole H2SO4. This mole here is aqueous. It's going to be neutralized by 10 mole percent sodium hydroxide. And what we want to find out is what is the Q that's released by this neutralization. So we're given one heat of solution here, and that's of our sodium sulfate. And one thing to notice is that heats of solution are given per mole of solute, not of solution. So let's start by finding the heats of solution for our aqueous solution. So this involves solving for R, so we can look them up. If we look at our H2SO4 aqueous solution, in one mole, there's 0.85 moles of water and 0.15 moles of sulfuric acid. So our R is going to equal 5.7. And when we look this up, we find our heat of solution is equal to minus 60 kilojoules per mole of H2SO4. Again, the solute, not the solution. Now we're going to do the same for the aqueous sodium hydroxide. And here our ratio is 0.9 to 0.1, since it's 10% sodium hydroxide, and therefore our R is going to be equal to 9. And again, we look up this heat of solution for sodium hydroxide with an R of 9, and we find that it is minus 41 kilojoules per mole of sodium hydroxide. Now we need to determine the Q. And our Q is going to equal this extent of reaction times the heat of this particular reaction. So how do we find the heat of reaction? That's equal to the sum of the heats of formation of our products minus the sum of the heats of formation of our reactants. What makes this different from other reactive problems is that this heat of formation is equal to not only the heat of formation of the solute, but also the heat of solution, or the heat caused by dissolving the solute in water. One way of looking at it is first we form the solute, which is that heat of formation, then we dissolve it in its solvent, which is the heat of solution, and the combination is the heat of formation of the aqueous solution. So now let's solve for the heats of formation for all of our reactants and products. And we'll start again with our H2SO4 aqueous. And that's going to equal its heat of formation plus its heat of solution. And so our heat of formation for aqueous H2SO4 is minus 871 kilojoules per mole of H2SO4. Now let's do the same with the rest of our aqueous solutions. However, we have to be careful not to leave out the water. Even though it's not dissolved, it still has a heat of formation, so we need to include that in our reaction. So now that we have all of our heats of formation, we need to solve for the extent of reaction. And I did it using our H2SO4. And so coming out, we have no H2SO4. Coming in, we have 0.15 moles of H2SO4 minus the extent of reaction. So the extent of reaction is just equal to 0.15 moles. Finally, we put this whole thing together. So our Q is going to equal our extent of reactions. And now we're going to multiply it by our sum of our enthalpies of our products minus the sum of our enthalpies of our reactants. What's important, though, is we have to multiply each one of these heats of formation by its stoichiometric coefficient. And when we add and subtract these all together, we end up with minus 22.7 kilojoules